Coming up on a special edition of How We Built It, we're joined by UK-based data engineering consultant Endjin, who specialize in big data analytics solutions for their customers in ocean research, financial services, and retail industries to see how they're evaluating Azure Synapse for on-demand serverless compute and querying. So I'm joined today by Jess Panni, principal and data architect at Endjin. Welcome to Microsoft Mechanics.
Thank you. It's great to be on the show.
Thanks for joining us today. And let's take a step back, though. Before we get into this, just a quick recap. If you're new to Azure Synapse, this is Microsoft's limitless analytics platform that really brings together enterprise data warehousing and big data processing into a single service. In fact, you can learn more by watching our introduction to Azure Synapse with John McIntyre recently at aka.ms/mechanicssynapse. All right, so Jess, your company Endjin really started your journey with Azure Synapse for data exploration. You're using things like SQL Serverless for kind of on-demand compute and also the data visualization capabilities. But can you tell us what's behind this?
Sure, yeah. So we've been working with a number of different customers with their big data challenges across a range of different industries. And we try and make their data more accessible and to take away the friction of getting insights from their data. Now, we also look at after their security and governance processes and needs as well. So we've been putting SQL Serverless through its paces on some of their most demanding workloads to see how it sort of stacks up with other services and technologies.
All right, so Jess, let's make this real for people. Can you give us an example about how this would work?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure. I can give you an example. So imagine you're an ISP or a telco, and you're providing broadband services to people, and you want to be able to identify who and where problems are occurring on your network so that you can prioritize where to send your network engineers. Now, clearly, a telco doesn't have a direct connection into your home, but there's a network of interconnected devices as part of their network infrastructure between you and them, which introduces multiple points of failure. Now, these devices are constantly producing telemetry, which we typically could store in an Azure data lake, which in this particular case, we're collecting about 60 gigabytes of data per day. We then need to provision a Spark environment, configure it, secure it, and connect it to the data lake. And only then can we spin up a cluster, which would usually comprise of at least three VMs for the duration of the exploration and development. And of course, if you're new to all this, you need to get skilled up in something like Python or Scala.
And that's really familiar territory for me, because in IT, then we have to use that. That's a dependency on us, which might mean additional time or cost to get those resources spun up.
Yeah, absolutely. I can take days, weeks, months even. And once you've found the insights and how to extract those insights, you need to operationalize the solution and build data pipelines so that you're continuously monitoring data as it arrives so that you can measure and find issues in the future.
Right. And those data pipelines also themselves pose a challenge because they might be running on different infrastructures, and then bringing all of that together can be hard. So how do things then change with Azure Synapse?
Yeah, I mean, I can show you how you can achieve all of this securely from a single environment without spinning up any pre-provisioned resources and using the language that you probably already know. Now, there are a number of steps we need to go through, and the first of those steps is understanding what data we have. So here we are in Synapse Studio, and one of the great things about Synapse Studio is we can now browse the files and folders within our data lake, and you can see here the contents of one particular folder, and we can see we've got a network telemetry folder, which looks interesting. So let's go and have a look inside there. Now we can see we have data partitioned by date and then partitioned by hour. And finally, we can see the raw files, which are in this case in Parquet format. Now, if I wanted to analyze these files, traditionally I'd have to run a Spark cluster or I'd need to download those files. But with SQL Serverless, all I need to do is go and select the files, right click on them, and I can select the top 100 rows. So I'm just going to run this, and you can see that we're running a SQL query over one or more files in the data lake without any provision servers. But what if we wanted to query over all our telemetry without worrying about individual files or where they live in the lake? And I can show you an example. So here we've got a view that I created called Radius Raw. It represents all our network telemetry. And I can use this query to find the total number of events that we've received on a single day. So if I run this, we can see that we've received about 50 million events on that day, Now, this view is completely reusable. We've hidden all the details of the individual files and even the formats of the data that we're querying. And as I say, all of this has been done without using any provision resources. It's fully serverless, and I didn't have to spin up a single thing. But I've got a slightly more interesting example that I can show you. So here's a query that returns network issues for a given piece of equipment by the number of customers who are impacted. And we're joining these issues over another set of files, which provides more information about the telco exchange, the devices, including geographical location. So we are limiting this entire data set down to a single day, and also just down to the top sort of 100 customers that are impacted. So if I run this, I just want to point out that the exchanges view is actually reading a CSV file, whereas the other view we're querying over is raw Parquet. So we're actually joining data stored in completely different formats. And you can see we've got some results quite quickly. Now, the next thing to do is to start sort of, you know, visualizing it, seeing, you know, what's in that data set. You know, how can we represent that that table in a better ways? Now, what I can do is I can go and have a look at down in the results view and change the view to a chart view. And I'm just going to make a couple of changes here. I'm just going to remove some of these columns and just leave the number of events and the number of distinct customers. And now what I've got is I've got a time series showing when peak issues are occurring, the number of distinct customers when that occurs, and obviously the number of events. So now that we've discovered how to extract insights, we need to be able to operationalize these. And to do this, we would typically run this query continuously as new data arrives, and we store the data in the data lake to make it easier for upstream processes and visualizations. So I can show you that here as well. What we've got is we've got an expression, a CTAS expression. And if you are familiar with SQL database or SQL data warehouse, you may have seen this in the past. And what this is doing is it's running the same query, but it's writing the output to a location in the data lake. So we're writing to a folder called output, and then within that a subfolder called network health. And now what we can do is we can go back into our data lake. I'm just going to drop out, and you can see we've got a new folder called output, a new folder called network health, and here are all our issues ready to go.
So now you've kind of got the data and the visualizations to really see where those different points of failures are on the network to be able to dispatch the right field text. But what would I do next?
Yeah, so the next thing we need to do is we need to make sure that our field engineers have, you know, good visualizations that are continuously running, pointing them at the issues, so they can react based on customer impact. Now, Power BI is a great data visualization tool, and the good news is that it comes integrated with Synapse. One of the first challenges is how do we get data into Power BI? Now, Power BI comes with a whole bunch of great connectors, and because we're just talking SQL here, we can use the existing SQL connectors with SQL Serverless without any changes at all. So let's have a look in Develop Hub. So in our Develop Hub, you'll see we now have a Power BI option, and we can see our Power BI workspace that we've set up. And from there, we can go and directly query the Power BI datasets within Synapse. So I'm going to add a new data set, and you can see that from Power BI's perspective, SQL Serverless looks like any regular SQL database. And I've got all my views in a database called Telco Demo, and I can download what's called a PBIDS file or PBIDS file, which is a Power BI file which has all the connection details set up, so I can immediately start querying our SQL Serverless views and tables without any other problems or delay. So, to save a bit of time, what I've done is I've already done that, and I've pushed up a data set with our network issues. And what I can do is I'm going to create a new Power BI report, and you'll see the report experience is now embedded in. Here's our network health data from before, and I'm just going to go and drop a map onto our report, and we're going to start hooking that up. So I'm going to pull the latitude in, the longitude in, and I'm going to make the size of my data points the distinct customer count. And you can see now we've got a nice hotspot graph. So I'm going to make this a little bit more interesting. We're just going to drop in a tree map for some navigation, a bit bigger, and we're going to do that by exchange, and again by the number of customers impacted. And now what I can do is I can start to navigate around the various different exchanges and see exactly where my issues are occurring at any given time.
And this is really great, but I know a lot of people watching probably are using Spark tables. So in that case, do I have to spin up and kind of run a Spark cluster against that data, or can I use SQL Serverless to do that?
Right, it's a really good question. So Synapse comes with its own managed Spark environment, which is great if you've got existing Spark assets and skills. But SQL On Demand also plays quite well with it. So I can show you an example of how that all works. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go over back to my data hub. And you'll see that we've got our databases. And if I open that up, you'll see we've got a special database there called Default Spark. Now, if I open that up, you'll see I've got a bunch of tables. Now, these are Spark tables. These are not views. These are not SQL serverless views. These are Spark views. And that last view there, Radius Raw, is a Spark table that I've previously set up and created. Now, in the past, as you say, what we'd have to do is spin up a cluster to actually view the contents of that table. But with SQL Serverless, all I need to do is start querying it straight away. So here we're doing another select top 1,000 rows. And here I am querying a Spark table without a cluster running at all.
All right, so we've been talking a lot about serverless capabilities really for that on-demand compute. But when would we start using provisioned resources then?
All right, so yeah, it depends really. Are we finding with SQL Serverless that we're getting really good performance? And given it's pay per query, it also allows us to attribute cost to business units. But you know, there may be a time when you need the performance of SQL pools. And because we're talking SQL in both cases, it actually makes it easy to transition from SQL Serverless to SQL pools. Remember the query I ran before? I can show at the top here, we're switching between our SQL Serverless environment and our SQL pool environment. I'm just going to run that. And while that's running, I'm just going to explain what I've done. I've pulled the same data, the same raw data into a SQL pool, and I've created a similar set of views in the SQL pool environment. And now I'm able to simply switch, run my existing original query, and I'm getting exactly the same results, but this time using pre-provisioned resources.
All right, this is really great stuff. Thanks so much for sharing kind of what you've been doing with Azure Synapse, Jess. But any tips that you would give people that are watching from home about how they can start using Azure Synapse?
Yeah, sure. Well, historically, so analytics has been seen as a big, scary, big budget kind of exercise. And Synapse provides a path to get you productive really quickly, but also allows you to graduate to more advanced services, you know, as and when necessary. Okay. So I suppose I'd say, you know, look for the simple opportunities within your data and grow your analytics solutions from there.
Good tips. Thanks again for joining us today, Jess. And also, if you liked hearing from Endjin, please check out the rest of our How We Built It series at aka.ms/Azure Synapse series to learn from early adopters who are also kicking the tires with Azure Synapse. That's all the time we have for this show. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.